What is up, my friends? My name is Kim, and if you like true crime like I do, go ahead and hit that subscribe button. I post 2 times a week, and you don't want to miss a thing. I hope you're having a fabulous day so far. Today's case is about Danielle Stislicki, also known as Danny, who went missing from her job, never to be seen again. She made contact with somebody, though. It was a security guard. A security guard with no interest in protecting women. Let's get into it. Danielle Ann Stislicki was a sweet girl that radiated positivity. She was born February 28, 1988. She was only 28 years old when she went missing. Her parents, Anne and Richard Stislicki. Danielle had 2 sisters, Colleen and Jillian, and 1 brother, Matthew. Everyone that knew her said she was upbeat, a happy person who valued her family, her friendships, and her cat, Adelaide. Her grandmother described her as, quote, "She was adventurous. She just had a spirit, loved life, always wanted to do the right thing by people. She was probably kind to a fault," unquote. Danielle worked for MetLife, and she worked out of the MetLife office on Telegraph Road in Southfield, Michigan. Danielle walked out of the MetLife office on December 2, 2016, only 28 years old, and was never seen again. Her family and the police did not believe she disappeared intentionally. Danielle that day was texting her friend, her best friend, Sarah Pollock. They had been friends since grade school. Sarah was having a bad day and was thinking about calling in to work that evening because she worked the night shift. And she wanted some company. And of course, Danielle, being a sweet girl that she is, wanted to be there for her friend. So they agreed that they would have dinner and Danielle would come over and spend the night. Danielle said she was going to be leaving work a little bit earlier that day, just before 5 o'clock. She needed to go home, she needed to pack a bag, and that she would be over. She had to pack a bag because she had to work the next morning. She didn't typically work the weekend, but she had to work just a short shift on that Saturday. And so she needed to go home, get some work clothes, and then she'll head over. Well, Sarah waited and Danielle never showed. Danielle never showed up that evening. Sarah thought, well, maybe she went to go pack her bag and she just fell asleep or something. But it was very unusual behavior for Danielle because, one, she always did what she said, and two, she would at least text. So when Sarah didn't hear from Danielle, the next morning she drove over to her Farmington Hills apartment. She saw that her car was parked outside of her apartment, which was odd because she was supposed to have worked that morning. So Sarah is like, well, I don't know what's going on. Let me go knock on the door. She knocks on the door, no answer. She goes around and knocks on windows, no response. She's yelling her name outside of the building, no response. So Sarah, desperate, ends up going to her car and just laying on the horn outside of her apartment building, and still nothing. I think we all need a friend like Sarah. Am I right? That's a good friend. Sarah, not giving up, calls Danielle's family to see if they've heard from her and let them know what was going on and that she was worried. Her car was outside her apartment and she's not answering, as well as not answering text. Danielle was known to always answer her text. Her family was concerned as well, so they ended up calling Danielle's grandparents, who had the key to her apartment. So all of her family heads over, they get the key to her apartment, and once they're inside the apartment, nothing really looked off. There wasn't any furniture knocked over, there wasn't anything damaged that they could see. But most notable was there was no Danielle. Adelaide, the cat, was very hungry. They did not notice anything missing from her apartment either. Her toothbrush, her makeup, everything was in her bathroom, showing she didn't pack her things up to leave. Danielle's family called the police. The police come out, but they're not too concerned. She's 28 years old. She probably just left with a friend. But this tends to happen a lot in these cases where it's an adult and their parents are like, no, this isn't like her. This isn't typical Danielle. But the police are like, well, let's just give it some more time. So they're still concerned. And so they tell the police, we need to get into Danielle's car. And the police are like, I'm sorry, we cannot break into her car. And so, and the mom said, hey, if you don't let us into this car, I'm going to break a window and you're just going to have to come back and deal with the alarm. And the police officer basically said, you need to do what you need to do. Which that could go two ways with me. Is he's like, I would probably do the same. Go ahead and do what you need to do. Or it was like, I don't care. But I think it was that way, not that he didn't care. But they were able to get a hold of AAA. So AAA came out and they opened the door. Once they were in the car, they saw that she had her purse, her wallet. There was all of her belongings inside of this car. And in her wallet, she had both her ID and her credit cards were in there. They were able to find the spare key inside of the glove box. And so now they called the police back and said, hey, she didn't just leave on her own. Her car's here, her wallet, her ID, her credit cards, her money, everything's in the car. So the detectives were like, okay, yes, we definitely have something to go on now. This is more serious. So the detectives assigned to this case got to work. I have to say the police work in this case was amazing. A lot of the time with these cases, we always are like, that was questionable, or they're not trying hard enough or whatever. In this case, I just cannot believe how much information, how much hard, solid police work was done in this case. So I definitely have to give them some props for that. That it's pretty amazing. And as we go along, you'll see what I'm saying. So they started at the last place that she was seen, which was the MetLife building. Deborah I am was her name at the time. She since got married, but her and Danielle walked out of the building together that day. Deborah was talking about a call that she had with a customer, and because Danielle used to be her mentor, that she was just saying, hey, I think I got scored wrong on this call. And so they were just talking about it. But then they came to a place where they needed to separate. So Deborah goes to her car, and then Deborah notices that Danielle walks over to a car, a gray Buick LeSabre with its hood up. There was a man standing next to the car dressed in a suit, pointing into the car as if there was trouble, like towards the engine, like, meh, you know. Deborah said she waited to make sure that she was okay, but it seemed like they knew each other, so she just left the parking lot. She later identified the man as Floyd Galloway Jr. Who is Floyd Galloway? Well, let me tell you. Floyd Russell Galloway Jr. was born January 23rd, 1987. He was married to Ellie Galloway. Ellie, who at the time was battling leukemia, so she was often hospitalized. He used to work as a security guard at the MetLife building. Since being seen with Danielle last, Floyd Galloway Jr. received 16 to 35 years after pleading guilty in a case involving a jogger in suburban Detroit's Hines Park that occurred in September of 2016.
Floyd Galloway, the man who admitted to attacking a Livonia woman while she was jogging in Hines Park, was sentenced today to 16 to 35 years in prison. Galloway was given the chance to speak. He said nothing, but his victim had a lot to say, and so did the Sizlicki family. Their daughter, Danny, is missing, and Galloway is the person of interest.
I will continue to fight, like I did that day, to make sure that you continue to pay for what you have done to me, and to make sure that you do not do this to any other woman.
The 28-year-old Livonia woman's message was strong. Then the judge had words for Floyd Galloway on the terror he caused.
You somehow felt you were entitled to choke this woman, beat this woman, and have sex with her.
All the while, Galloway stood motionless, had an opportunity to talk, but said nothing.
A couple of months prior to Danielle going missing, investigators say he attacked her, dragged her into the woods, and tried to remove her clothes, but she was able to escape. Not a good person. But Floyd once was employed as a security guard at the MetLife building, as I mentioned, but he was reassigned to another location in October due to the building being sold. He worked at a different site in December, so why was he at the MetLife building in December when he was let go of that site in October? But he was there the day that Danielle went missing. Floyd's boss confirmed that he called in to work that day that Danielle went missing. He was typically scheduled to work 3 p.m. to 11 p.m., but he didn't show up to work that day. Danielle's mom also worked at the MetLife building with Danielle. Her name again was Anne. Anne recalls seeing Floyd around the office as he was the security guard. She recalls him taking a liking to Danielle. Once he came to the cafeteria on the fourth floor where her and Danielle were eating lunch, she thought it was a bit off because security guards typically were not on the floors, but rather they stayed at their station or in the lobby or out front of the building. There were other times he would watch her or Danielle walk to their cars, you know, to make sure that they got to their cars safely. Anne brushed it off as a simple office crush with her daughter and Floyd. Her daughter was not interested in Floyd. They would talk about her boyfriends and things, and she was not interested in Floyd. So let's go back a year prior to Danielle going missing. Danielle received some mysterious flowers. The card read, "From Secret Admirer, hope this made you smile today." She received this around October 2015 timeframe. So this was a year prior to Danielle going missing. Danielle found these flowers at her desk. Floyd texted her not too long after her receiving the flowers and asked her if she wanted to hang out. She, of course, declined, but asked him if he was the one who sent her the flowers. He said he wasn't. He didn't send the flowers. They exchanged about 8 text conversations over a year time span. These text messages were always instigated by Floyd. Danielle was just too nice to tell him just to get lost. Why the flowers on her desk was a concern is because no one was allowed on the fourth floor. Someone would have had to have seen them come to deliver the flowers because they have to pass through security. And she was wondering if they had worked in the building. She was excited, of course, to get the flowers, but as equally as creeped out. They would later find this card that was on those flowers when they cleaned out Danielle's apartment after she went missing. The writing was examined by an expert, and it is believed that it is the writing of Floyd. But that doesn't prove anything, so they keep digging, and what they find is amazing. Not only did Deborah, the lady that she walked out of the building with, see her talking with Floyd, there was another gentleman by the name of Brandon, another employee of MetLife. Well, Brandon saw Floyd in Danielle's car. While stopped at a stoplight, Floyd was in the passenger side and Danielle was driving, as if Danielle was giving Floyd a ride home or something. Brandon would testify at the preliminary hearing that he didn't think much of it. He didn't really know Danielle outside of work to have an opinion, but did identify that it was Floyd in her car. Okay, so I'm just going to lay out the information based on the preliminary hearing with Floyd being their main suspect. They believe that Floyd faked car trouble in the parking lot of Danielle's work. His car was recently purchased within a few months of the alleged car trouble, but the dealership documentation proved that the car had been inspected. There was no problems with the car, that it was in tip-top shape. But Floyd, knowing that Danielle is such of a kind person and banking on the thought that she would give him a ride home, because he was stranded, and it was in the middle of the day. It was somebody she knew. He knew that his house was going to be empty that evening because his wife was in the hospital receiving treatment for her leukemia. He was able to get Danielle into the house, killed her by strangulation in his bedroom, drove her car back to her house, parked it, walked to a local Tim Hortons, ditched her keys and the Fitbit on the path from her house to Tim Hortons, took a cab back to MetLife building area to pick up his car that he had left there with the car trouble, and went back to his house, cleaned up the scene. Okay, so that was a lot of information. That is quite a theory. How could they know all this? Well, let's get into it. Danielle's car was seen on CCTV just around 5 p.m. heading the direction from MetLife to Floyd's house. And it is seen again 3 hours later heading the direction from Floyd's house to Danielle's home. So they suspect that Danielle drove to his house, but he drove her car back to Danielle's house. Then once the car was dropped off, Floyd locked up the car, left the car, walked over to Tim Hortons. He is seen on CC footage at the Tim Hortons where he purchased a cold brew and asked to use their phone. This is 2016. 7-year-olds have cell phones, but he asked if he could use their phone. He is seen on the CCTV getting a sticky note out of his pocket, and he dials the number from this sticky note. Floyd called a cab. This could prove premeditation and clear planning by having the cab company phone number pre-written down that he grabbed out of his pocket. You can tell he is not using the tips of his fingers when he dialed. I don't know if that was noticeable to anybody, but I was like, why isn't it? Oh, I get it. He is seen on CCTV at the Tim Hortons at a table waiting for a cab to show up. So you can see the cab pulls up, he gets into the cab, but once he got out of the cab, he paid in cash. Again, premeditation. And the cab driver did confirm it was Floyd in her cab that day. So once the detective saw that he was at that Tim Hortons, that he must have made the walk. It's less than a mile from Danielle's house. So the detective decides to make the walk from Danielle's house to the Tim Hortons. What does he find on the way? He found her car keys and her Fitbit from just doing the walk. What amazing police work in this case. I just couldn't believe it. So they found her keys and her Fitbit on a path from Danielle's house to the Tim Hortons. It's just amazing. This walk only took the detective 11 minutes. So he is seen again once he exits the cab. So I kind of went on a little deviation there, but so he gets in the cab at Tim Hortons. He gets out of the cab. He's caught on CCTV again. From that CCTV, it is not far from the MetLife building. So he gets out of the cab. You can see that he kind of walks like he's going to walk into this apartment building, but then he switches directions and he heads towards the direction of the MetLife building. Because remember, his car is still at MetLife because he had jumped in the car with Danielle. And so the MetLife building from this apartment building where he was dropped off by the cab driver is only 100 feet, or it's only 1,000 feet away. So the detectives now have enough evidence. So they get a search warrant, one of three search warrants for Floyd's home. It was around the 7th or 8th, I can't remember, but is when they started their search because she was missing on the 2nd. And once they're in Floyd's house, they found some cutouts of carpet next to Floyd's bed. Carpet pieces were found in the garbage, and they noticed a fresh, clean, white comforter on the bed. They later found that Floyd had purchased this comforter only days after Danielle's death. He bought this from Bed Bath & Beyond. They found this information based on credit card transactions and more CCTV of him being in the store purchasing the comforter. There's a couple theories, rumors, whatever, around this comforter. So it is believed that he possibly rolled her up in this missing comforter and either burned her possibly and then disposed of it, the ashes, or the second one is that he rolled her up into the comforter, loaded her into her own car, and then on the way back to dropping her car off at her place, she was dumped into a dumpster and that she's possibly at a landfill. If this is the case, they possibly may never be able to retrieve her remains. Either way, it was significant that he purchased the comforter because the old one has never been found, nor has Danielle. Detectives took the carpet that was replaced along with the surrounding areas of the cutout carpet so they could test it. The carpet was tested positive for biological fluid. They tested this against Danielle's toothbrush, and it is a high possibility of being hers. The pathologist later testified that the fluids are likely from a strangulation, that these types of fluids are bodily secretions that either come from your nose or your mouth that will occur after a strangulation. The body was not found, but still they can identify death, the cause of death, by technology. I'm telling you, it is a beautiful thing. Technology is. But surprise, surprise, Danielle's cell phone data showed her in the area of Floyd's house after the time she last was seen. Floyd's phone conveniently was turned off at this time, again, showing premeditation. It also showed that at one point, Floyd turns on his phone just after 6 p.m., and it shows both Danielle's phone and Floyd's phone in the same location. Presumably at his home, based on the tower data, his phone then goes off again just before 8 p.m. Her phone is still being on and travels through cell phone towers to indicate leaving Floyd's home in the direction of her apartment, finalizing at her apartment before her phone was either turned off or the battery died. The phone, the cell phone, has never been recovered. But what was interesting is Floyd's phone was picked up on cell phone towers, indicating he also drove through the MetLife parking lot just after 11 a.m. before Danielle went missing. So the day Danielle went missing after 5 o'clock, right? At 11 o'clock in that or 11 a.m. on that day, Floyd's phone was picked up in towers driving through the parking lot. Floyd was trying to see if she was at work that day and where her car was parked. He was scoping out the scene. He's a shitty, shitty person. Detectives also found an Apple tablet in the car of Floyd's house in the driveway. The tablet was tied to Floyd by email and photos. There were searches such as group chat for family of sex offenders that was done on December 8th. And on December 9th, there was another search, how to pass a polygraph. It's not looking good for you, Floyd. So based on this information, there was enough to take this to trial. The judge was like, this is overwhelming information. We're going to trial. But because of the state of the world, the trial has been pushed out a few times. He is in prison already for the attempted rape and kidnapping charge. So he's not at risk to the public right now. But about the rape case and his wife, well, she stayed by his side after the rape charges. He was a suspect in Danielle's kidnapping, but she stayed with him and they ended up moving in with her family's house. I'm trying to see what she was thinking. She must have been thinking, oh, we've been married for 4 years. This is just a misunderstanding. I'm not really sure, but they had to move out of their house because they were being searched. They were searched 3 times over a course of weeks, and also these searches would last days. So they would move into Ellie's family's house. Eventually, she's had enough. You know, he was convicted of the rape thing. He's still a suspect for Danielle. She's like, I'm done. So she ends up divorcing Floyd. But what's sad is that she ended up passing away not long after, which is super sad to think that she spent her final days in such distress. The ricochet that occurs with these heinous crimes stretches so wide. But yeah, she spent her final days in divorce. Her husband is found to be a rapist and possibly a murderer. It's just like, wow, I feel so bad for her. I have no doubt that he will be convicted with the evidence that they showed in this preliminary hearing, but I'm really interested to watch the trial to see what other information they have, what other evidence they have. I just wish they would find her body. I know her family desperately would like to find her body and put her to rest.
You need to do the right thing.
You are the friend that was supposed to meet her that night.
Yeah.
And today you get a little bit of closure.
It's not enough yet. I mean, to have her home would be closure. The constant wonder of where she is and when we're going to be able to say goodbye.
Another thing was that wasn't part of the preliminary hearing was that Floyd's sister-in-law went to the police telling them a conversation she and Floyd had. Floyd admitted he was a sex addict. When he told her this, her response was, "Don't cheat on my sister." He did. In the worst way possible.
Newton feels like her brother-in-law, Floyd Galloway Jr., knows exactly what happened to that jogger here in Hines Park back in September. And she also feels like he knows what happened to Danielle Sislicki. And for her, watching this all play out hasn't been easy.
I wanted him to marry my sister. You know, that's how likable he has been. And that's how loved he has been. But, you know, I guess we never really know anyone, apparently.
Elizabeth Newton is talking about her brother-in-law of 4 years, Floyd Galloway Jr. She says news of his arrest in connection with a violent attack on a female jogger only reaffirms her belief that he has something to do with the disappearance of Danielle Sislicki. Galloway Jr. knows Danielle because he was a security guard at her workplace. He hasn't been charged in that case, but is a person of interest. Newton says she has long been troubled by his silence over Danielle.
I just kept having the question, why isn't he saying anything? Why doesn't he speak? If he did something wrong, then he needs to own up to it.
Newton has been vocal about her suspicions, and because of that, she says aside from her mother, her family hasn't spoken to her, and that includes her sister.
I find it especially interesting that he was dressed in a suit that day, the day that he allegedly had car trouble and he got into Danielle's car. It's like a typical classic sociopath, in my opinion. It's as if he became and dressed as someone she could trust. I'm in a suit. I'm not going to hurt you. Not to mention he was a security guard, another facade. A security guard could never hurt you. You can trust me. It's so scary. It's as if you cannot trust anyone, it seems like. A very sad and tragic case of an evil person. I will definitely be watching the trial, which I believe is now scheduled in mid-October. And I can update you guys after the trial if you're interested in an update video. Just let me know down in the comments if this is something that you're interested in. Well, you guys let me know what you think of this case. Do you think he's guilty? Do you not? Have you been keeping up on it? If you guys have made it this far, you guys are rock stars and I love you to death. There are more true crime videos in my Captured Killers playlist. If you're interested, go ahead and check that out. But either way, stay safe, my loves. And I'll see you in my next one. Bye.